inside and outside. New in everything but the name.
Chrysler for 1955. The car with
the $100 million look.
See it now at your Chrysler Plymouth dealer showroom.
WCBS, AM and FM, New York. By transcription.
Thank you. Thank you, Perry. Very nice. Very warm words of welcome you've given me there. It's going to be pleasant. I want to tell you working next door to you.
This is Ken Carpenter welcoming you to the Bing Crosby Show.
Moonlight becomes you. It goes with your hair.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Bing Crosby. You know, we're launching this evening a new series of programs to be heard over your local CBS outlet every night, Monday through Friday. Now, this little 15-minute filler is not going to attempt anything too serious or too profound. I don't think I'm qualified to occupy that sort of position in the public scene. We're not going to get too hokey either. We're not going to yak it up much. Just going to venture a few opinions, which we hope will be sensible and which we hope will apply to the passing scene. We're going to have some guests from time to time. You know, when we can get some outstanding figure to hold still for a minute. And there's going to be remarks on sports and show business and social activities, literature, outstanding books that we run across. There are quotations from some of the new books. We're going to talk about a few characters that I've known, and, well, we might discuss some civic enterprises, things like that, and, of course, from time to time, we're going to lay on a few encomiums here and there where they seem to belong. I have Buddy Cole and an excellent musical group here this evening, and I'd like to interrupt myself for a moment with a song by myself. It's a bright spiritual, and it's a big hit right now, thanks to Rosie Clooney. This Old House.
This old house once knew my children. This old house once knew my wife. This old house was home and comfort as we fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter. This old house heard many shouts. Now she trembles in darkness when the lightning walks about. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. Ain't I gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window panes. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. I'm getting ready to meet the saints. Getting shaky, this old house is a getting old. This old house lets in the rain, this old house lets in the cold. On my knees I'm getting chilly, but I feel no fear, no pain, 'cause I see an angel peeking through a broken window pane. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. Ain't I gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window pane. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. I'm getting ready to meet the saints. He don't know I'm gonna leave, else he'd wake up by the fireplace and he'd sit and howl and grieve. But my hunting days are over, ain't gonna hunt the coon no more. Gabriel brought in my chariot when the wind blew down the door. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. Ain't I gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window panes. Ain't I gonna need this house no longer. I'm getting ready to meet the saints.
Thanks, buddy. And boys, you know, folks, I think we can launch this new series with a note of high hope. If I may call your attention to four or five things which have happened in the past few weeks and seem to me to indicate a surge of exceptional honesty now prevalent. Sort of a renaissance of honesty, particularly, for instance, on the sports scene. Like on one occasion this fall,
A very important football contest. I think it was down in Texas. And you know that there's no football game in the world more bitterly contested than a football game in Texas. A halfback on one of the teams called a penalty on himself. A penalty which the official had failed to detect. And when the official called the penalty, according to what the boy had told him, it resulted in the opposing team scoring the winning touchdown. Of course, you all know the football rules. There's all kinds of them. In fact, football pundits tell me that actually there's an infraction of the rules on almost every play of the game. You could just see what would happen if players started calling fouls on themselves religiously. It might take a whole weekend to play a complete game. And then the late TV show could easily, could still be the football game, still going on. And, of course, this thing happened down on the golf course the other day, here at the Tamarisk Golf Course in Palm Springs, where they were playing the Southern California Open Championship. It seemed to indicate to me that the trend is spreading to golf. A professional named Jerry Barber, he was competing in the Southern California Open Golf Championship, and while he was playing in the final round, and he was right up among the leaders, he got to the fifth hole and hooked his tee shot a little bit and put it in the trap, a very deep trap. Well, he finally played out of the trap and played on up and finished the hole. And instead of the five, which everybody thought he had scored, Jerry told the official scorer to credit him with a six. Because when he was taking his stance in the trap, getting ready to hit the ball, you know, he accidentally brushed a few grains of sand with his club. For you non-golfers, I might say that this is breaking the rules. And the infraction, although it wasn't seen by anyone in the gallery, Jerry's disclosure of what had happened resulted in him finishing in a tie with Bobby Rosberg for the championship instead of winning by one stroke, which he would have done if he hadn't called the foul on himself. It would be nice if I could report that Jerry Barber won the playoff, which was necessitated by the tie with Bobby Rosberg. And I can so report because he did. I won't try and draw any obvious moral here, but Jerry's got a fine wife and five youngsters. At least he told me he had five youngsters, and I guess I can trust him. And he can doubtless use the money. He shot a 68 on a long, tough, windy course. Congratulations, Jerry, on your golf and on your unique integrity. Well, that's a couple of incidents of honest men. Now, I want to tell you a couple of stories which indicate that the unusual rash of probity seems to be spreading to the girls, too, because down in Georgia, a little girl named Ann Warren, she's a 12-year-old seventh grader from Monticello, Georgia, she shares with another girl the honor of being Georgia's second best speller. And little Ann might have occupied the number one position all alone if she hadn't called the judge's attention to the fact that that they had marked only three words wrong on her final paper, when actually there were four words wrong. The fourth word was, it's a word I never heard of. Xerphophyte, I guess you call it. X-E-R-P-H-O-H-Y-T-E, which Anne had spelt with a Z-E-R-O-P-H-Y-T-E. She certainly could have fooled me. Then there's another case which I ran across that seems to be very much in point, and it involves a girl named Bernice Martinez. She lives up in San Francisco, and she's a hat check girl at the St. Francis Hotel there. And one morning, she found an envelope on the floor of her little cubicle containing $11,000. Well, Bernice turned the envelope into the hotel authorities, and they found the owner of the money, and Bernice was rewarded with a $500 tip. Oh, yeah, and the fella got his hat back, too. I can imagine a person leaving $8,000, $9,000 laying around, but my goodness, never know $11,000 in a plain, unaddressed envelope. But it certainly shows, doesn't it, that there are definitely hopeful signs that the people are getting more honest every day. If it would only spread to politics, we'd really be in, wouldn't we? But it does seem that with the paper so full of crime rampant and lawbreakers of all kinds, it certainly seems nice to read about these very nice people and these instances of such firm adherence to correct behavior. Well, then, shall we get along musically? Here's one of the big smashes from Pajama Game. Hey There.
Hey there, you with the stars in your eyes, love never made a fool of you. You used to be too wise. Hey there, you on that high flying cloud. Though she won't throw a crumb to you, well, you think someday she's gonna come to you. You'd better forget her. Her withered nose in the air. She has you dancing on a string. Break it and she won't care. Won't you take this advice I hand you like a brother? Or are you not seeing things too clear? Are you too much in love to hear? Is it all going in one ear and out the other?
Buddy, while we're rolling here, what do you say if we segue into the old favorite?
But not for me.
They're singing songs of love, but not for me. A lucky star above, but not for me. With love to lead the way, I've found more clouds of gray than any Russian play could guarantee. I was a fool to fall and get that way. I owe a last and also lackaday. Although I can't dismiss that memory of her kiss, I guess she's not.
Well, that's tonight's closer. I hope we can get together tomorrow night, same time, same place, for some more of the same. Take care.
Yes, Bing?
You think I talked too much tonight?
Not to me, you didn't.
That's what I mean. Forgive me, Ken. I got carried away a little with the sound of my own voice. Good night, folks, and thanks.
More than 10 million Americans suffer the pain and crippling deformity of rheumatic diseases, arthritis, and rheumatism. Contributions for research are needed. Send them to Arthritis, care of your local post office. Bing Crosby was transcribed over the CBS Radio Network.
Stay tuned for the Amos and Andy Music Hall.
Rosemary Clooney with Mitch Miller.